everybody. It's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com, and today we are again at the Redeemer United Church of Christ in Sussex, Wisconsin, with Rick and Nancy Vollbrecht on our prairie tour, and this will be our spring prairie tour. What do you have?
Well, when we last did a video with you in the fall, we were talking about seed collection, and we talked about how we go around and collect some of the seeds that we want to disperse elsewhere on the prairie, and then also how the birds help disperse them and eat them for food. So we thought we'd look at one of the ones that we looked at last fall, and this is compass plant. You know, we don't, over the course of the winter, a lot of these stalks will fall down, but many of them remain standing, and we just let them be as they are. And if you look here, there are still a few seeds remaining here. When this flower is in bloom, it's like a sunflower, and the flower itself is probably about 6-7 inches in diameter, and in the center is a what looks like a sunflower head, and these are the remaining seeds that from this one. Everything else either been eaten by birds, picked by us, or perhaps just dispersed by the wind as it falls off. But every one of these seed heads is just about perfectly clean. And one of the neat things about leaving the stalk standing is that we can then identify the leaves that are below it. When the compass plant is in bloom, and some of these get to be 9 feet tall, the leaves are very identifiable. Now, these are obviously all brown and curled up, but they have a very distinct look, like fingers. And we can, if we look down at the base of this flower, we can see here's this year's growth. And it looks just like fingers, so it's very easy to identify. So we know without the stalk here, we could even identify that that's what's going to grow here. So
it's amazing to me that those leaves start out that little, because they will end up being this big. You know, it's
like fishing, right? It's that big.
Yeah, right. Right.
So as we look around, you see a lot of the remains of compass plant here. We probably have over 100 of compass plant growing here, and they're just a beautiful flower, and it provides, as you say, food for the birds, and it's just one of those things that's fun to look across the prairie and see hundreds of them, 6, 7, 8 feet tall in the course of the summer. But then you want to point out?
Yeah, behind Rick here is another tall plant that's in the sunflower family. I believe this is rosin weed. Again, all the seeds are gone, but that huge big leaf clump is so exciting to see, because that's going to be this year's plant, and it looks very healthy, and I really enjoy seeing that.
How tall will the leaves get? Because I'm guessing these leaves
are different. No, they actually have some leaves on the stalk.
Oh, okay.
And they're not real big. But yeah, most of the leaves are down here. And they can't really, I'm not exactly sure. I don't remember how much bigger they get.
They're fairly
small. Yeah.
And as the plant, the new plant growth comes up, all of these stalks will eventually just fall over. They break off as the new growth comes in. Sometimes we get annoyed with them because they are taken away from the beauty of the new prairie coming in, and we'll just knock them down. But
sure.
We don't really need to do anything.
Just break them off.
It's something, if we want to get the kids involved on the prairie, that's something that's fun for them to do, all that cracking, and then they can.
Or if you're frustrated.
Right. Yeah. It's a good tool for that.
Like bubble wrap.
Yep.
Release the krakens.
And then you just return it to this land.
There you go.
And the good news is that all of the stuff, as it decays, adds to enrich the earth around here. And this property originally had a lot of clay soil in it, so it's not real good for a lot of growth, but the prairie seems to thrive on it very well. And over the years, we know as the old plants break down, they're just constantly enriching the soil. So eventually,
and don't the native plants have really deep roots? Mm-hmm.
They do.
So they're pulling the nourishment up from below.
On a plant like this, the roots could easily go down 4, 5, 6 feet.
Wow.
And what that helps with is in the drought conditions. We had a couple summers ago, it was very dry.
Last year.
And a lot of these just continue to thrive because they're going way down and getting what water is down there. So we really don't have to, not like your garden at home, you may want to water it because you feel sorry for the plants. Here, obviously, with this 4 acres of prairie, we couldn't water it all. But nature just takes care of itself. It's very hardy.
Last year, as you will recall, we talked several times about how it was a dry year. And the coppice plants didn't get nearly as tall as they actually do. So now, this year, we're starting out quite wet. So we'll see what happens this year. This is another flower that some of you might recognize. It's purple coneflower. And these seed heads are so unique when you see them. And it's amazing, there's still quite a few seeds left on here. But then you can see this one only has a couple. So
somebody's been eating.
We've been working on trying to get more of these growing, so I'm happy that I can find them now. But down here again, these are the leaves, and this plant again looks quite healthy. So that is another exciting thing, because I like to have more of these. And then if you look over there, there's several clumps. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 at least, different areas with purple coneflowers. And those seeds, some of them land on the ground and some of them might reseed. So that's good too. The prairie does not bloom in the spring, really. A lot of prairie plants like a lot of sun, and they really come into their own end of July, beginning of August. But there are a few, and this is one of them. This is called Golden Alexander, and we have a lot of it here. It's just starting to bloom, and this is the flower head. It gets a yellow flower that's probably this big, and it's flat on the top. And some people were worried the first year that they saw it, because they thought it was,
garlic mustard?
No, that poisonous plant that if you rub it on your skin, you get, I forgot what it's called now.
I just saw that one.
Anyway,
yes.
This is a very friendly plant, and it likes moisture, so that's why it's here in this lower area.
Wild parsnips.
Yep. Yeah. But it's very prolific. If you, I have this in the garden too, I'll show you. And these seeds, between the seeds and the roots, it just keeps coming up everywhere.
Wow.
So my job is to keep it where it's supposed to be and stop it from going everywhere else, or we would have a Golden Alexander garden and nothing else. Between that and spiderwort. Spiderwort's another spring blooming prairie flower. It's beautiful. It's a little purple flower. It probably doesn't bloom till June.
Oh, I think I know that one. It used to be in our raspberry patch.
And the seeds blow everywhere. And you get these little plants everywhere you don't want them to be.
It's a very
so that's
plant,
another one.
Though,
so it is.
It's a fun,
it is.
Fun one to
but
look
you
at.
Can only have so many in a mm-hmm. garden where you'd have nothing but.
Right.
So.
Okay, now we're out in our sanctuary garden where we have 6 flower beds all filled with native prairie plants. And one of the interesting ones that's already started to bloom is one right in front of us here called prairie smoke. It usually comes up at about this time of the year, and the flowers are arranged usually with 3 buds on each stalk. And what will happen in the next month, they will start getting bigger and eventually they will stand upright. And the interesting thing about them, they will all develop long, hairy strands that will be about 2 inches long. And there'll be, I don't know, 50 of them maybe on each of these buds.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
And it really is interesting. It's called prairie smoke because the story is that when the pioneers, the settlers came across this area, there were fields just filled with these. And when they got to their full potential, and you look across the field, it would look like the field is on fire and that the smoke is rising from it. It really is a pretty flower. We'll
that
have to
is.
Come back and look at that in another month or two and see what it looks like. Okay, now we're at the back end of our property. We've just gone past the sanctuary garden area. We're into a woodsy area. couple of years ago, one of the members of our church, a young man, earned his Eagle Scout badge by completing a path through here and putting up some benches, birdhouses, and it gives us just another little extra area to find other types of plants. Before he did that, we didn't even know some things were back here. And we have since discovered some fairly significant areas of some spring beauty, some wild geranium, false Solomon seal, and some violets, some other things. And we've kind of worked to enhance that by adding some flowers. You want to talk about what we've got behind us here?
Okay. The woods in spring is the best place to find flowers, because in the spring, the leaves are not on the trees. And the flowers need light. So flowers come up really early, April, and bloom before the leaves come out. And these flowers are called spring ephemerals. And there's a very nice a variety of them. And they bloom really fast, and then they're done. And they need sun, like most other plants, and so when the leaves come, they're done blooming.
Ephemeral, I think, means short-lived.
Yes.
And they live up to their names.
Yes,
that they,
yes,
do.
They do. So we discovered when we had this path that we had a number of them back here we didn't know about. So we've kind of roped off some areas that we're trying to focus on, because of course back here we also have a lot of buckthorn and other stuff we don't want.
And garlic mustard.
Yuck. So right now, back there, is Virginia bluebell blooming. And we did buy, we also tried to purchase a few things too, so I think that we bought the Jacob's ladder. That's the shorter purple ones. Because they have those little signs there, so I'd remember where we put them. These are May apples, and I don't see, oh yeah, there, underneath.
The flower is hard to find.
Yeah.
This one is budding, and it's underneath. And eventually this will turn into a nice little white, little green tint flower.
But if you didn't look and lift up the leaves, you'd never see it. Also here, these are violets. Something chewed them off the other day, as you can see. I don't know. And those are Virginia waterleaf, which will bloom later. There's more back here.
Is that bloodroot right in front of you? The remains of the leaf?
Oh, here, yeah. Bloodroot is one of the very, very early things. It's a cool plant. It's done blooming now, and it only blooms for, 4 days, 5 days maybe? The leaf is wrapped around the flower stalk, and then the leaf opens up, and this beautiful, like, 7-petaled white flower blooms. And then it's done, within days. Done. But these leaves are so distinctive that you can remember where they are. We have a number of them. So I want to show you back here. There's some more May apples here. This is a May apple. No, this is
bloodroot.
Bloodroot, yes, thank you. That's bloodroot.
Wood violets that are growing. Those we just found here too, and we found some deep in the woods, and we've transplanted a few so that we can put them out where they're easier to see.
This is spring beauty, and it is a beautiful little white flower with pink lines when you look really close. And it comes up and blooms like crazy for about 7 to 10 days, and then it's done.
Put your hand next to it just for scale.
Right there.
Yep. Very delicate.
It's really pretty. And there's quite a bit of it. We have a big patch of it back here. Pink.
Yep.
I really would like to move it up here it's closer to the path and more visible.
This is one of the areas that we discovered once that path was put in.
We had no idea.
We just came across these, and they're so beautiful. There's probably 100 or so in here.
Oh, easily.
Mm-hmm.
But like Nancy said, we're trying gradually to transplant some of them up to an area that's a little easier for more people to get to.
And if you come back here in like 2 months,
you'd never believe that there were actually pretty flowers blooming back here because it's pretty dark. And thick and
overgrown.
Dense and overgrown with undesirable things. There's only so much time.
Right. Yes. Nature has her way.
Yes.
And gradually we're thinning out some of this area. There's some buckthorn and honeysuckle back here. We're trying to eliminate that as we find it. But that's a slow process. And then we're trying to bring in some better plants just to give it a little more beauty back here. And now we're back out by the sanctuary garden. I should have mentioned before that it looks a little messy right now because one of the things we do in the fall, we don't remove any of the dead material. We like to let it sit there over the winter. Again, it provides seed for the birds, but then also in the spring, it makes it easier for us to identify where the valid plants are growing. So as we start weeding, we can identify and we don't pull out some of the good things. We do one pass through and we cut down all the dead stuff, leaving short areas of it, and then we'll gradually start weeding some of the weeds that are in there, and then sometime usually around end of June, early July, we'll bring mulch in and cover it, and then we're pretty set with weed control for the rest of the year, and we even watch the garden grow. There are a lot of plants, different kinds of plants that we have here, and Nancy's going to talk a little bit about what we have here.
Well, it's spring, so that means I have to try to remember all the names from last year. And usually every spring I have to get out the book and go, now what was this one called again? Because when you're doing the gardening, like Rick said, it really is helpful to have the stems. So you can see the difference between, oh, this is a healthy plant, and this is either a little one that jumped off and I don't want it growing there, so I'm getting rid of it, or it's a crabgrass or dandelions, or those are the two most common things we have that are not welcome here. But, oh gosh, in the spring, mostly there's spiderwort coming and golden alexanders blooming, columbine we have in the spring.
Prairie smoke we saw before.
Yes. And then in the summer, oh my goodness, there's liatris, there's coneflower, there's
lead plant.
Do you have some Batista back here?
Yes. Baptisia? It's up there.
That's what I thought.
It's in the memorial garden part. And I have more seeds at home than I know what to do with. Because the bushes get really big.
We were highly efficient collecting seeds last fall.
Yes,
we were successful.
Yes. Because then in the fall there's a lot of asters. Oh, and we have bergamot. A lot of bergamot back there too in the memorial garden.
Well, it's a fun place to visit in the summer too because there are a lot of butterflies. I've seen maybe four or five different kinds of butterflies here.
And we have butterfly weed.
And we have a lot of bees, which I always think is a good sign. It's healthy for the prairie. It's healthy for the bee population. Mm-hmm. And there's just a lot of them here. So that's fun to watch them.
So it's spring and we're excited because we have another whole growing season to look forward to. And this year we're starting off with more water, so I'm anxious to see what difference that'll make from last year when we had a precious little water. So
you might have noticed too, there are some peony towers throughout here. We have peonies growing here.
No.
But a lot of the native plants, they seem to thrive back here and are very healthy. They get very tall, and in order to keep them from falling over, we've picked some of the bigger ones and we've put the towers there to establish as they grow that they support and will stand upright. Otherwise, it just looks like a mess back here.
We would like to thank Nancy and Rick for showing us through the garden again on a new season. We haven't been here in the spring before. And it's wonderful.
Thank you.
It's just fun to watch, and it's so fun to go through with you guys because you know what you're talking about, and you
know what
the plants are, and what we can expect for the next season too. So that's always good. So if you enjoyed this video, please give us a thumbs up, and if you'd like to make comments or ask questions, we'd love to have you do that. And always, you're invited to join our garden family and subscribe.
Connect with us on YouTube.